Welcome back, my dear soul friend. I am so excited about this episode. If you have wondered, do you have the ability to connect to the other side? Do you have multisensory abilities, high intuition? Do you want to expand your intuition? Are you curious about being able to heal yourself? Stay tuned because we got all into those questions and into depth. Today's guest, who I'm so thrilled to introduce you to, Marie Manuchehri, is a nurse, former nurse, and today a psychic medium and energy medicine healer. She's been doing this on her own for the last 25 years. Marie is an author. She is a public speaker. She's a teacher. She is a sweetheart and such a lovely, amazing, warm human being. Marie offers courses that are all about how to connect in to your own intuition, and she has a weekly podcast called Where Energy Meets the Divine. Marie is also author of the book Intuitive Self-Healing, which was published by Sounds True. And I just invite you to, as always, come open-hearted, open-minded, and to allow this information to just really seep into your soul, into your consciousness. And as always, I hope that this delicious conversation we had adds value and life and energy and a greater connection to yourself, to love yourself, your USG. And I won't give it away, but this is one you're going to want to make time for. It is a rich and beautiful and spiritually eye-opening, third eye-opening conversation. So I hope you enjoy. So I'm already giddy and giggling and like cheeks are just burning with excitement, smiling because I can't help myself. I'm so excited, Marie, that you're here. I've wanted to interview you for a while and I'm so grateful. Thank you for coming on to the USG podcast. We are all so happy to have you here.
Oh, well, thank you. It's my pleasure and honor to be here, Julie. And you are a delight. You're just a beautiful beacon of light. So it's my honor to be here.
Thank you so much. Well, let's talk about this beacon of light and being a light, which you are, of course, as well. And I would love to, for those who don't know you yet and your story, I just found it to be very profound. Can you just share? I know it's a big question to be like, hey, can you tell us about your childhood and how you got into this like medium thing and psychic intuitive thing? But maybe just to give a little backstory, what it was like growing up in your household, were there other mediums? Was this something that was expected? Like, how did you get into this work? I'll let you just kind of share because it's a cool story.
Well, great question. I didn't know. I knew that my grandmother was psychic because there was these stories. It was my mother's mother. There was a story that when my uncle was off into World War II, and nobody could contact anyone, right? Like we didn't have cell phones at that time period. You would get a telegraph at some point if your loved one had passed. And my mother's family, I think they were living in Oklahoma at the time. I'm not exactly sure. And my mother was setting the table and her mother, my grandmother, said, put an extra plate down. And my mom said, why? She goes, well, Leroy's coming home. And my mother looked at her mother like, you're nuts. What are you talking about? We don't even know where he is. And sure enough, they all sat down at the table and he knocked at the door at dinner time and came home for more. Wow. So I knew they were psychic in the family. I wasn't taught how to use it. My mother's very intuitive, but more from a place of warnings. You know, she kind of looked at psychic from a scary place, you know, not from that place where you feel the connection of your higher self and your divine connection to all of your multisensory experiences so that you can use it in this human life and let it perform for you well. Our childhood was kind of chaotic, 5 kids all a year apart. My parents divorced when I was 7. I'm the oldest. And so it was a little cray cray in our house. But one of the things that really worked for me in terms of having that type of upbringing, I was granted a lot of freedom on what to think and believe. I wasn't given, well, you have to believe in this religion or you have to believe in this particular politics. I was given a lot of freedom to have my own unique thoughts and perceptions, which I think helped me years later when I began to see something within myself that I didn't know I had. I had read a lot of books on spirituality. I read, Seth Speaks at a young age because all those books were in our household because my mother believed in intuition and psychic ability. So I wish I'd had some training. I think my mother didn't get the training that she needed either. A lot of intuition in terms of professional practice skipped generations, for some reason. So I have three daughters and, I would love it if any of them would follow me in the craft. They all have very intellectual jobs. One's a professor, one's a lawyer, and one's an engineer. And they say, yeah, Mom, we really would love to come into your job too. And we help each other with intuition. But I always say, maybe one of the grandkids. So I've actually saved my original massage table when people used to come into my home. Yeah. For years and years, I would see 25 people a week that would come into my home and I would do energy work and intuitive readings and mediumship. So I've saved it in the garage because it probably has a lot of good juju in it for whoever in the family, whatever generation may want to follow this very fun, high frequency, beautiful, fulfilling line of work that I feel blessed to be a part of.
Mm. I just love the whole, that foundation. I'm getting like that fertile foundation was there with your mom and the openness. Maybe you can share a little bit, because my understanding is you started in the nursing as a nurse and you were in hospitals and right. To just share like a little bit about your story, how you kind of came into this, and we can then get into some, I know some of those stories were just incredible that I've heard, what you experienced, but you weren't on this path in the beginning, right?
Yeah. I mean, I've always read spiritual texts. I've always prayed. I've meditated. Yeah. I've had, prior to the age of 37, I had experiences that were very profound, but they didn't happen often, like maybe every 5 years or a decade would go by and I'd have some incredible psychic experience, but it just didn't happen every day. And I didn't know how to make it keep happening. I could really actually just savor those moments for a long period of time. Like they just shook me to my core in a very positive, uplifting, reaffirming awareness of how uniquely our lives can be in the multisensory world while being in human form. But my family is super holistic. I was married at the time and I had helped my children's dad through college. And then when we were all done with that, I'm like, I want to go to college, because I dropped out of school to put him through school. So I was kind of jealous. Like, I want a degree. Yeah. And he said, you should become a nurse, which was like very against my really strong holistic family. My mother never took us to doctors unless we had a fractured bone, or I once had an asthma attack, so she had to take me to the hospital. But she would always take us to Chinese herbal medicine doctors or chiropractors. All my children had a chiropractor session right after they were born. So our family is very holistic, and my family wasn't supported, my family of origin, that I decided to go to nursing school. I took some prerequisites, loved it. And even though my logical mind is going, what are you doing? I just felt this joy. And I just wish everybody would learn how to embody for them personally that feeling of joy, because it really is your yellow brick road. It's never going to make sense to your logical mind. Intuition will also never make sense to the logical mind. And we need to learn to ignore the logical mind when it comes to following our path and our destiny and intuitive choices that are in alignment for us. And I really think that's where humanity is stepping into right now, is moving into this place where we recognize the difference between logic and intuition and love that part of ourselves, our logical mind. Like you and I have to have certain lighting in our rooms and make sure we have something to drink while we talk, and that dogs and kids are put away for our conversation. So that's all really lovely, but intuition is what gets you onto your path. So I went to nursing school, loved it, ended up working in a hospital, loved every moment of it. I miss it still every single day. Although I love what I do more. And I believe when you're doing things that bring you joy, your vibration is so elevated. You just have a higher opportunity to connect to the multisensory world. And I ended up working on an oncology floor. So you can imagine my family. Not only am I working in modern medicine, and then I'm working in one of the harshest chemical aspects of modern medicine. And I kind of ended up on the oncology floor, not by choice, but I had had some tachycardia while I was working on a different floor in the hospital. I used to work three 12-hour graveyard shifts, you know, because we worked opposite shifts when we were raising kids. And I started having tachycardia, so my heart started racing. And I finally went to a cardiologist on the floor, and he did a week's worth of testing and said it was my biorhythms were off because of the graveyard shifts I was working. And he said, you need to go to day shift immediately. And the only shift available was on the oncology floor. And I loved it also, the oncology floor, but that's where I opened up. That's where I began to hear my patients' organs speaking to me and telling me why they were sick. Not just the fact that we were giving them chemicals to hopefully heal, but the underlying cause of their diseases. And it's also where I had my very first medium experience that I had clarity about anyway. And I was thankfully very much supported by my staff. It was my nurse supervisor. When I went to her, because I worked charge nurse a lot, and I started to hear and see things, and I was distracted. And I thought, if somebody runs a code, and the charge nurse has to run the code, you know, if somebody crashes on the unit, we have to go get the crash cart. We have to call the code team. We have to start. It's a big procedure. And I had a rule that nobody codes on my watch, that if people were really ill, we would get them transferred to the intensive care unit in time, or we would have their code status changed, because our patients were in-house and they were extremely ill, extremely ill. So I went to her saying, I'm hearing and seeing and feeling things. I thought for sure she was going to suspend me, order a psych eval, because I would have done that if I were her. And I hadn't even told when I was married at the time, I didn't even tell my husband what I was experiencing. He had no idea. And I thought, I'm going to have to go home. I'm going to be fired. And then I'm going to have this appointment with Dr. Sandman, which was our in-house psychologist. And just the thought of it scared the gajibis out of me. And to my shock and ultimate delight, she said, you're seeing energy and you need to start laying your hands on our patients. I know. And it took me a while to do it, which is hysterical, because I've been touching patients for years, you know, and touching for their pulse. I'm changing sutures. I'm putting IVs in. I'm, you know, listening to their heart. I'm touching people all day long. But there's a different thing when you touch with intention of moving energy, which I didn't really have the language for it at that time. And so the very first person I laid hands on was a woman who was a surgical patient. She wasn't a cancer patient. And there was an overflow on the surgical floor. So she was on our floor, and she really needed to go home. Like, she had had her procedure, but she was in pain, and they didn't know how to help her anymore with the pain. They were just waiting so that she could be discharged. So I asked her if I could lay hands on her, and she said yes. And as I did, I began to see what I now know are chakras, but these beautiful, colorful orbs of light that lined her entire body. But I had not studied energy medicine for some weird reason at that time. And we both cried. I had my eyes closed. I used to have to close my eyes when I did energy work initially to kind of close out the physical world, because I can see really well psychically. My clairvoyance is a very strong ability. And so I had my eyes closed, and I opened a couple of times, and she was crying as well as I was. It was a really magical experience. And I found out that she was in grief. That's why she was in physical pain. She had had a hysterectomy, and she knew she wasn't going to have any more children, although she was already in menopause. She wasn't going to have any more children. But I think just for some reason, it was just like this final that it's impossible now. It can never happen. I don't have a womb. So we had a lovely talk about it, and she was able to go home the next day.
Wow. That is, I feel like there's such a divine guidance in your story with having was it the head nurse who told you?
Yeah, the supervisor of our entire floor.
In a hospital, like this is not a, this is a I'm assuming a large corporate hospital that's, she's saying, oh, you're, I mean, what a, to me, it's like, you know, you can look back and see just in here, wow, this is just so divinely led up and lined up for you to have her say, oh yeah, you're seeing energy and lay your hand. I mean, what a gift, Marie, you know, that was encouraged. I know I do want to talk about, I want to come back to something you mentioned in a moment about normalizing intuition and psychic abilities. You and I were chatting about this. Before we go to that, are there any stories you can share, even just one or two? I don't want to give away the one I heard, but it was so profound where
I won't remember which one it was, unless you want to, you know, give
me a hint. I think it was a patient's mother showed up and
oh yes. Oh my gosh.
I was crying. Yeah. I was on my way to the dentist and he was like, why are you like, what happened? I'm like, I don't know where to begin this story. It, like touched me. I was just bawling.
So I will tell that story. How about that?
Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Everything psychically began for me in the hospital. And which, again, if you're doing what brings you true, authentic happiness, you're in a higher possibility of being shown your magnificence. Like everyone's magnificent. Everyone's naturally gifted and talented. And whatever those gifts or talents are, will be extremely fulfilling for that individual. But a lot of people don't have a lot of things that authentically bring them joy. And if it isn't your job, it's okay. But what are you doing on your days off and, you know, your evenings? Are you, you know, finding things that truly fulfill you and uplift you? So I had been laying hands on patients for probably over a year by then. I was training myself. I'm a self-taught healer. I'd already started a small practice at home because people just started randomly showing up at my house. They would knock on the door and say, I heard that you're a healer. And I don't always use that word to describe myself because I believe people heal themselves. Yeah. And I'm a facilitator of that. Mm. And so people had to lay on a couch for a while because I didn't have a massage table. And there's kind of an interesting story about that. My kid's dad, we had an office in the house and it had all of his weight room equipment in it. And I was trying to talk him into buying massage stuff. And he kept going, why? And I go, I don't know. I just know I have to paint the ceiling and I'm supposed to do some healing work, but I don't really know. And he was saying no. And I was not an independent housewife. He kind of ran the everything. And I didn't even have access to our checking account. I was pretty naive to say the least. And one of his friends came over who also had kind of tight purse strings in their in his relationship with his wife. So I thought, oh gosh, now I'm never getting this stuff. But his friend came over and talked my kid's dad into buying everything. And this was in like 1997. It was like $2,000 worth of stuff because I like nice things. So it was going to be a nice massage table and, you know, everything that I needed. And so I got everything. He moved all of his weight equipment out. And a few months later, the gentleman that was his friend that came to the house and talked him into buying all the equipment was diagnosed with a brain tumor. Mm. And it was non-cancerous, which was excellent, but was in a tricky spot in his brain. He laid on my table for 4 to 5 months before he had his procedure. And then I was able to go into the ICU, although it was a different hospital than my hospital, but because I was an RN, and I laid hands on him immediately postoperatively, and he had a full and complete recovery. Mm. And of course, I thank the neurosurgeons for all their incredible work that they did, but energy work can really enhance, you know, whatever's even going on medically. So I think that this friend unconsciously knew. You know, his guides were telling my children's father's guides, buy everything that she wants. You will be very happy that she did. And many people in our community who had disease processes laid on my table and I helped them to heal. You know, healing has a lot to do with a shift of perception as well. And that's a big part of it. So back to your original ask, I'm in the hospital. I already have a small practice at home. I'm working, I think I was working on call then, so I could build my practice at home. And I was a charge that day, and you have to get there early, like 6 a.m. And there was hardly anybody on the floor when I first arrived. And I saw this really weird thing. I knew it was intuitive. I knew it was psychic, floating at the top of the ceiling. It was like this beautiful kind of satin cobalt fabric that was folded. And the ceilings were very high in this particular hospital. And as I looked at it going, and I wasn't surprised because I've just been seeing and hearing all kinds of weird stuff for a while now. As I looked at this fabric, this woman's face kind of contorted out of the fabric. And if I were to guess her age, I would say she was maybe in her 70s, maybe older. And she said to me, and when beings speak to us, they speak mental telepathically. She said, will you please go take care of my son? And I worked on a pretty big unit. We were at that time onc, tele, and medical. I don't think it's a good combination, honestly, but we were really busy. And so I said to her, I go, I don't know who your son is or where he is. And she just kind of disappeared. But every time I walked down that hallway the rest of the day, she was kind of begging me to go into his room. And I would kind of give her the same answer. I was kind of tired. You know, I was a little worn out. And it wasn't until like 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And she was kind of yelling at me at some point, you know, like, go see my son, kind of pleading with me. The last, you know, moment that I'm walking down the hallway for the last check-in with the other nurses to make sure they were okay so that they could go home too, a door started to glow, which was in that same hallway. And that's when I went, oh, so it was glowing intuitively. That's where her son is. And I asked his nurse, because all the staff knew what I did, but before I would go in and introduce myself to their patients and do whatever I was going to do, I always asked their permission, you know, and so the nurse said, sure, you can go in there. And this man was probably in his 30s or 40s. There was a woman sitting next to him by his bed. I assumed it was his wife. He had been diagnosed with a terminal illness. And when I walked in the room, I said, so has your mother crossed? And he said, yes, she had passed. And I said, would you call her kind of fierce and a little grumpy? And they both laughed and said yes. And then he introduced me to his sister. So it was both of her children were in that room. And I said, I told them both that she had been bothering me all day long. Can I please lay hands on him? Because she wants to say something, you know, and I didn't know what it was. I had no idea. So they said, yes, I laid hands on him. And she told me that it wasn't his time. He had pancreatic cancer, which, you know, is very difficult to cure still in throughout the world, as far as I know, definitely in the U.S. And he didn't share this with his sister, but his mother knew, because people on the other side can read our minds. They know what we're feeling. And he had thought that he wasn't going to be able to go home, that this would be his last, you know, few moments on earth or days or weeks. And she said, no, you have time. You're going home. I want you to enjoy this space. I will see you soon. And they were crying the whole time that I was delivering the message. And it was a beautiful moment for me that, you know, I need to be more mindful of these surprise visits. That was my first medium, consciously knowing that I was having a medium experience with, you know, humans and people living on the other side.
That is such a, there's humor in there. I feel like it's like, we laughed, we cried. Like there's just so much in that story. And also the thing that I love so much is the being of service, the healing aspect, the ability to, it's like connecting the dots, the souls, you know, the living. And I know that's part of what you do. It's such a powerful one. And, you know, I am curious for those listening, Marie, we talked about this a little bit and I was sharing a little bit of my own kind of, wow, I just really feel like my intuition and these abilities are opening up big time. And there's a bit of, I'm getting hot as I say that, like, what is happening? And you were talking about, you know, just normalizing that, which I love. And maybe just to, and I know you've worked now with you said doctors, physicians, therapists, and it's becoming more quote unquote normal. But I think what you said earlier, you know, our logical left brain, I think is the area we gotta love up on, because I think it just can't make sense of this. It can't get its hands around, it can't make sense of this. So curious to hear your thoughts, what you think is, I know this is like a big question, but what's happening? I think more than it's not just me, there are others. I know people that have written in that are just feeling like greater opening, more receptivity. What, talking about normalizing it, and what do you think is happening on a macro scale with intuition?
I love your question. You know, I've always taught all my clients about intuition. It's one of the things that I do because I believe people are their greatest healer. And I'm certainly happy to provide whatever I can provide for students and clients. But I think if people can start to begin that process, and I have tons of tools and techniques because I research it for my own self so I can be as successful as possible and accurate as possible when I work with others. Like, that's critical for me. You know, no one's 100% accurate, not even an MRI machine, but it's important to be as accurate as you can be. So what I think is happening on a global level is that I know this is what's happened. The vibration of Earth has increased. So many people worry about the planet and worry about the way the world is right now. But in truth, we are more peaceful than we've ever been in documented times. We live closer together than we've ever lived in documented times. And so the vibration of the Earth is elevated. I always think of the Earth as a female, but everything is meant to be a mixture of male and female energies in unison. But I tend to refer to the Earth as female. So she's really happy. She's in high frequency. One of her favorite things to do is to nurture. And she has, 8 billion human souls on her, you know, gorgeous self, plus animal life and plant life and single cell organisms. I mean, there's just a ton of creatures. So she's extremely happy. She's in a very high frequency. So when the Earth is happy, then humans have more of an opportunity to find their own personal joys and happiness. And even though we just, you know, recovered from a pandemic, that pandemic also brought some uniqueness to the human world as well, where more people can work from home, which is actually beneficial, where people can, you know, wear what they want to work, eat healthier food, go take a break and go for a walk or go get a latte. So that's actually helping and assisting humanity. People can spend more time with their families instead of, you know, transporting their body an hour away from their home, you know, have 2 hours of commute or things of that nature. So that's even increasing the vibration of the human world. And just recently, just to add from an astrological perspective, we just had Pluto move from Capricorn into Aquarius, and Aquarius is a highly humanitarian frequency and vibration. So we're all, you know, we're all meant to be multisensory here on Earth. And I know it won't happen in my lifetime, but at some point, people won't need professional psychics or mediums. They'll be able to quickly connect with their loved ones, have that precious awareness and individualization about their path and who they are and what they truly want. And yes, what will help people move in that direction is to recognize your logical mind will never understand intuition. And there's nothing wrong with that. The logical mind is just that logical. Intuition is 1,000 times more accurate than the logical mind. And so if people just start to have some sort of belief about that, then they're going to start to recognize the difference between logic and intuition and maybe do a little research on it for themselves personally and take a few risks. Like, intuitively, I think this is the right thing. Recently, I was buying a new mattress for my room. And, you know, intuition's harder sometimes with yourself. And reading people you've never met before is the easiest. That's why one of the reasons why I love to teach courses online is I have people go in breakout rooms and read each other. And they don't know each other. They may not even live in the same country. And they're always shocked and surprised that they got information. I go, well, you're not emotionally involved. It took me a couple of days to figure out what mattress to get. And I really did pick the right one. I was so happy. You know, I'm like, oh my God, this mattress is perfect. So part of the process is when the logical mind tells you something and it's opposite your intuition, you're on track. So I don't hate my logical mind. I don't yell at it. I don't complain to it. I love it. It actually helps my intuitive process because I know when my logical mind tells me something, which is what people need to learn, is to be able to differentiate between these two experiences. One is a feeling, and a lot of people create what I call mind-made emotions, which are not authentic. I mean, that's where most people are in their connection to their emotional aspect. They're in mind-made artificial emotions, but real emotions are calm. They're compassionate. Mm. There's a relaxation to it. So once people start to work with themselves that way, then they can have this, oh, well, that was scary. And intuition is never scary. It's not a frightening kind of experience. It's a very calming, relaxed experience.
Mm. What you said about it being, I've done a little for my left brain, my sweet left brain, I've done a little data research evidence, like literally, because I had a major experience happen in my life where my intuition woke me up, like legit in the middle of the night type of situation. And I started, you know, this is now 14, 15 years ago, I started looking to see when I listened to it and when I didn't. When I went to logic versus intuition, I had to see it and see, oh, wow, there's data like there. And I'm usually not like that, but I think for something that is just, we live in a society that I think still is pretty left brain dominant, you know, our school, our systems. And so the fact that you said, and I did not know this, that intuition is 1,000, I was like, hold the phone, rewind, come back. 1,000 times more accurate. Okay, friends listening, hold on, take that in. Okay, take that in. That, I mean, that's, I think that's partially why I'm so passionate about this subject, Marie, and you talking about it. And I want to get into, because I can hear someone saying, and I'd love to hear your definition. So, okay, how do I tell the difference between my mind and my intuition? I heard that question. I think someone has that. And that's a very powerful statement. 1,000 times is not 10 times. That's huge.
Wow. And so that means that the majority of us are not making decisions that are in alignment with who we are, what we want. Most people don't even know what they want. They don't even know what happiness feels like. That's just maybe not the people who are listening to your podcast, but right. The majority of the population has not even checked into that. They, you know, they like, I have to do this to survive. Then I have to do this to survive. They're in constant fight or flight. They're activating their adrenal glands. They're overproducing cortisol. They're just, you know, making poor choices on top of poor choices. And we've normalized this. You know, I don't mean to say anything negative about what I'm going to say, but I'm always shocked when about a mile from my house is a McDonald's. And there is a line around the block, practically 24/7. And, you know, I think an occasional junk food is fine, but I would definitely not eat that. I don't even remember the last time I ate anything from McDonald's. So I don't mean any, you know, negativity toward, you know, this is a planet of free will. This is a multi-universe of free will. Everybody gets to make their own decisions and no one is judged about anything, quite frankly. But it's just like, I can feel confident that when people are making decisions about what to put in their body and it's not healthy for them, they are not connected to their body because their body is not saying, yay, let's go have some more of that. It's not saying that, you know?
I know mine is not. The few times it's like, oh, that was clear.
And our body has an opinion about everything, you know, and it will never shame or blame. That's the other thing about intuition. It's not shameful. It doesn't blame. Everyone is honored, regardless whatever choice or decision they make. The universe loves and adores everyone. Everyone is a part of creation, an irreplaceable part of God, if you will, or whatever language you want to use. And so, you know, no one is judged or criticized in any way, shape, or form, but wouldn't it be nice if we checked in? So one of the things I teach, and I may not go into all the depth of it, but I teach people how to get out of their head. And I work mostly with older souls, empathic people, those are whom are attracted to me. And for all kinds of reasons, you know, we already know that the majority of people spend a lot of time in their overthinking analytical brain, and the brain was not created to process or analyze anything. So it was created just to, this is logical. This is the next step. Like, You know, we have to color coordinate the handles at gas stations because people are not present. They're not paying attention. And they have put the wrong gas in their cars and destroyed their engines. So we have to color coordinate that because people aren't present. So if people can remain present, and people are for maybe nanoseconds, but if they can remain present, then they're going to move excess energy away from their brain. And then empathic people spend way too much time in their heart chakras. And what I'm about to say is not what most spiritualists say. You know, most spiritualists say, get in your heart chakra, hang out here. I think that's healthy for younger souls, but older souls are so empathetic that they tend to overgive, overnurture. They project their own insecurities on people. And so it slows them down and it doesn't allow them to stay aligned to their own happiness, their own fulfillment. And their heart chakras are already well formed, you know, so it's not like they have to work on becoming more compassionate. I think older souls need to work on self-compassion to reach that place of mastery. You have to allow your compassionate spirit to include yourself, and it's something you have to check on and work on constantly. It's very challenging. I have, you know, people who work for me, and the other day I was just spoiling one of my employees, you know, happily. And I'm like, gosh, I wish I was that nice to me. You know? Mm. At the end of the day, I'm like, wait a minute, you know? So I encourage people to stay away from their heart chakra and their brain, because we have 7 primary chakras in the body. And most people are, you know, here and here. But to rest in the lower half of the body, because that's where we connect to the authentic emotional response system, where our real feelings are, it's really connected to the second chakra, but any place from the hips down to the toes, if you wiggle your toes, I have a blanket on my lap because I live in the Northwest, and I let myself feel the blanket as I'm talking to you. I let my glute muscles feel the seat where I'm sitting. It's something that I constantly do so that I can be as present as possible, aligned to my authentic feelings, not what my mind is telling me what I'm feeling, not what that when people aren't in their heart chakra accurately, then they are in over sympathetic mode, and then they're not making the best choices for them. The heart chakra is supposed to be neutral. It's called the universal love, and the universe thinks that everything's beautiful, including war and famine. And many empathic people don't allow their heart chakra to function in that way.
That is profound. First of all, that resonates 100%. And I know that I would say probably 99% of anyone listening or watching right now, yes, you are resonating with this, because this show tends to attract highly sensitive, empathic old souls for the most part. And it's interesting, Marie, what you're saying. It's so beautiful because, you know, I got the image of Divine Mother, Mother Earth, like connecting those lower chakras. That's been very healing for me. I resonate with the high empath. In fact, I was like, how are you in a hospital? I would have to, I mean, today I have more tools, but to shut that, to really be present and not take that on. I love that what you're saying, you know, it's also like we live so neck up. And so coming down into the rootedness, your sacral, your emotions, your connection to Mother Earth, like this just all resonates as you're speaking. I can feel, we had talked earlier about channeling, like conscious and unconscious. I'm like, oh, this is you, and there's definitely divine wisdom coming through you. I can feel it.
Absolutely. Yeah. For all of us, you know, Everyone has that ability. It's normal to be multisensory.
That's right.
And so we're having this, I think, in this year, you know, so many people are trying to predict different things about the year, and I don't really see that much changing. I think the human race is really slow in global consciousness, and that's what is required in order to make the big shifts that we want to have. And they will happen at some point. And there's really nothing wrong with the Earth. It was created to be this unique planet where there's light and what we consider darkness, so that we can have clarity about what we want and our choices and what we don't want. But I think that the vibration of individuals is really upticking, and people are running at higher frequencies. Yes. I think that's precious and amazing. And that's why they're waking up. And that's why they need more assistance, or to listen to a podcast or read a book or take a course, because they're like, what the heck is happening? I even said that to my mother, even though I knew that my grandmother was psychic. What I didn't know is that my great-grandmother was a healer. Nobody in the family told me. Wow. And I was in my kitchen with my mom and I go, I don't know what's happening to me. This is just so weird. I don't get it. She goes, oh, well, you're just like great-grandmother Lucinda. And I go, what do you mean? And unfortunately, I didn't know a lot about Lucinda, which wasn't her birth name. She was a Cherokee Indian who was living on a reservation when my great-grandfather married her. He was a French man and they were living in Oklahoma. And so when she got married, she moved off the reservation. His brother married one of her cousins. And so they all lived on this ranch. And on the weekends, people would come to the ranch for healing that my great-grandmother and her cousin provided. And people would do trade. You know, they would repair fences or feed animals. And they did that for many years. But I didn't know the story. No one had told me that. And so when my mother told me that, I went, okay, not that we need things to make sense, but like my logical mind wanted some sort of evidence, you know, but we don't really need that. That's really not necessary. But I'm grateful that that story was shared. And like, why wasn't that shared before? You know, how come I didn't know that before? I don't know. I didn't even know any of that. It was really interesting.
I think sometimes with stories like that, first of all, thank you for sharing that. And I love like the breadcrumbs, like, oh my gosh, like this, look at the past. This is so cool. I think, and this is sort of goes to what you were saying, that there will be a time, we are multi-sensory. There'll be a time where this is normalized. And my sense is like, I'm realizing my aunt, my dad's sister is a psychic medium. And in fact had said something to me before going to college that was like 100% spot on, that I remember when it happened 6 years later, I'm like, oh, that's really interesting. And I remember it was kind of like you didn't talk about it a whole lot. Like you just kind of, oh yeah, that's what she does. She's got that ability. It's different today. I think though, the like pulling that story out is so powerful for you to see like, oh, it's in my past. And I just imagine the day, I don't know, just like I'm hearing somewhere over the rainbow, but maybe it's not that far off, where it's just, this is how we make decisions. This is how, because what I found is this is what I got from you. I mean, we were talking earlier, like you just light up. You look like you could be young, very young. Like you're just joyful, light. You're
very happy. Yes, happy. Very fulfilled. Yeah.
Yeah. And so, you know, the question I think of is, okay, so what can we each do to be more joyful and happy, to connect to that frequency, that energy? It's really tied into, Marie, when I talk about being your USU, I really picture what you're talking about, like your soul self, your joy, your happiness. And it feels like the connection to intuition is more seamless when we're in that vibration. Not that we're saying to be happy all the time, that's not possible.
It has to be authentic. And I agree with you. I think you have to do research. You know, when I was, before I started opening up psychically, I recognizing I was like this very naive, you know, young, I got married when I was 20, so I'd never lived alone. And we had always listened to my kid's dad's music, you know, and one day I went, I don't think I like that music. And I didn't know what I liked. So I actually went to a festival in Seattle in the summer. It was a music festival. And I just would walk to each stage and sit there and listen and go to the next one and the next one. So I went, oh, I already knew I loved R&B. I loved disco and R&B, I know. But I love jazz. I love jazz. So you have to kind of check it out. I recommend when I talk to students or clients to take a weekend. And you can either choose 5 or 10 things that you're going to notice that lights you up a little bit or expands you. And remember, your brain's going to go, well, that's ridiculous. You know, like one of my daughters hates jazz and my kids are super smart. Like they're, you know, really smart. And sometimes I'm like, well, she's right. It is kind of a messy, you know, it can be messy jazz. And so for a moment, I'm like, well, questioning, you know, years ago, questioning my decision that I like jazz. Yeah, I guess I like it messy. I like it layered. I like a lot going on. You know, I just love jazz. So the logical mind will interrupt what you've decided, like, oh, I like to go for a walk every morning. Oh, I like to stay in bed for an hour after I wake up or whatever it is. And then if you can keep connecting to that regularly, like I have a dog because I love to walk. So, and he's big, so he needs lots of long walks. And now I have to walk him even when it's 20 degrees in Seattle, safely, you know. So once you have that established, you could start with 5 or 10, then you repeat those. You make them be a part of your life. Yeah. And that keeps your vibration elevated. And the reason why, so think about it, that the universe vibrates at a very, very high frequency.
Right.
And humans, we vibrate our energy in a lower frequency, but we can raise our vibration and the universe can lower theirs to a certain degree. And then we can connect and get solutions and answers that are fulfilling. Mm. There are so many solutions to any problem or decision that we need to make. We only, because we use our minds, get one or two, and we usually don't like either one of them. Yeah. And so we're trying to make a decision of the lesser of the two evils when there are so many options and solutions that are very creative and unique. And that's the fun part of intuition. You just become a different person. You choose very different things, and yeah, you notice your life just gets better and better and better.
Amen to that. And absolutely. Absolutely. You know, one thing you had said earlier, what I've noticed, I'm curious, and then I do want to talk about healing and shifting perspective, because you mentioned that. I'm like, we're going to go there. With intuition, you mentioned that the signature of it is there's a calmness. And I think what I've noticed is, you know, it's calm. It's not always something easy to hear, meaning it was, I know for me, the time, especially the bigger moments, it was a pretty intense, like, oh, I need to look at that. But it was very calm and very, it had like a energy to it. It has an energy that's just, it feels like earth energy. It doesn't feel like the racing mind. And I think that's what you had mentioned earlier. Just so it can be, I think sometimes where I see people get tripped up, maybe you do too, is maybe what you're hearing might be, okay, I need to look at that. That can take courage, but to get that, it's never going to be shouting at you, or it's not like that. It's loving.
It's loving. Very loving. And real, yeah, emotions, when people feel their real emotions, they're calm too. And real emotions and intuition are actually in the same field of the aura outside of our body.
Wow.
So when people start to feel their real emotions, like, unless I get out of my head and drop and ask, what am I feeling? I just assume that I don't know what I'm feeling. I don't listen to what my brain tells me. And the human mind will tell most people that their emotions are going up and down all day long, but they actually aren't. Mm-hmm. When you discover a real emotion, it will, it won't change for another week, 7 to 10 days. I know, isn't that fascinating? And so you don't have to check it every day, but I like to check in every day just so that my mind goes, no, we're not frantic. We're not angry.
Yeah.
We're not annoyed. And if you are really angry or you are really sad, there's this calm observation to it. Like, real grief is beautiful. It's very pure. It's extremely, yeah, profound. It's incredible. You know, real grief is really quite beautiful.
Mm.
But humans tend to have mind-made grief or mind-made traumas and, yeah, things of that nature. Yeah.
And when you say the real emotion, so it might be grief, it might even be anger, but it's processed and it's showing up differently than in the mind. Or are there certain emotions that you would say, what would be those real emotions? I'm just hearing someone ask that.
Yeah. Well, all of the emotions, like guilt is not a real emotion. That's a mind-made emotion. It's not, yeah, real, right? Shame is not a real emotion. That's a mind-made emotion.
Got
so
it.
Like happiness, true sorrow, anger, you know, those are real emotions, but most people have no idea what they're feeling. In fact, because I've worked with thousands and thousands of people around the world, because I still have a practice. I just only see 6 a week now instead of 25. And what I've determined is about 98% of the people I've seen always think they're sad, depressed, and unhappy, but they actually are happy. And then there's a smaller percentage, and I'm in that percentage where I think I'm happy all the time. And sometimes I'm not. I'm mad about something that happened 2 weeks ago. And when you have that observation, you go, oh, wow. So it's not like you get angry, but you have that awareness like, wow. And then you can do something about it. Then you can, yeah, nurture yourself. Like, I'm sorry, you're angry. sweetheart or honey or handsome or whatever words you want to use. And then you can do something about it. You can talk to people about it or in the future make a different choice. But if you don't know what you're feeling, you're reacting to mind-made emotions, you're disconnected to your authenticity. And most people who don't think they're happy are.
Wow. This is, I call it like mind glowing. I would say no one wants their mind blown. Mind glowing. It's mind glowing. We need to use
I love wording that term. That's beautiful. I love it. Mind glowing.
Wording matters. It's actually, I'm going to be writing about it because I'm like, I don't want my mind to be, I'm no blown. Thank you. Glown. Yes. Glowing. Yeah. Fine. Yeah.
Yeah. That's beautiful.
It's just beautiful what you're saying. And I am curious, do you get in a certain state? Like, do you have, you know, the mother show up when you're in the grocery store, someone's mother who's, you know, the clerk? Do you see auras? Like, is it like a circus for you, Marie, at all times? Or like, I mean, do you dial it in?
I don't need drugs. I feel like I'm high all the time, you know? So, but I've made rules because, you know, early on in my work, I was at a grocery store close to my house. I was shopping and I have particular diets. Like I don't eat gluten. I don't eat a lot of sugar, you know, and I'm shopping. And I just know that someone on aisle 5 needs a colonoscopy. And so I've got my cart trying to crash into them so I can start to have a conversation, which I did do, by the way. And I even told them what I thought. They were not happy. They didn't want to hear what I had to say. They didn't like it, you know, and then I'm buying all the wrong food because I'm kind of discombobulated, you know, and I'm feeling bad. And I'm sitting on the curb with my groceries for some reason, you know, I didn't even make it to the car. And I could hear my spirit guides, the universe, whatever you want to call it, say to me, you're in the yellow pages. If someone wants to know about their health or their wellness, or let them come find you. So I took that message really clear. And yeah, there are many times I'm in the grocery store and I'm at the checkout counter, let's say, for example, because this wasn't too long ago, and I can see someone's departed parent standing right next to them, begging me to talk to their child. And I don't, because he or she's going to start crying. Then the line's going to be really long. You know, it's going to be a thing. I did have an experience. I don't know if you heard this story where I was in a restaurant and I was with my girlfriend. Her name was also Marie. And I'd had a glass of wine. I'm not a big drinker, but I'd had a glass of wine. It was a Friday night. And I went into the restroom and a dead person came into the stall and started talking to me. She told me that her husband was in the restaurant, that she had just died, that she had had a chronic condition that was being regulated. I think it was lupus, actually. And then she just had a flip in her health and went to the hospital and died. And so she told me he was in the restaurant and she wanted me to talk to him. So I'm peeing, you know, on the toilet, literally. And I'm having this mental telepathic conference with this lovely woman. She's probably in her 30s, really young looking, short, cute blonde hair. And so I'm telling her, I go, well, I'm not working right now. Here's my office phone number. And she just disappeared. When they get frustrated with me, they just kind of disappeared. But then when I walked out to sit with my friend and we were sitting in the bar, actually, she goes, you weren't going to believe what happened. And I go, what? She goes, this man came up to our table. He told me that he was with his twin brother whose wife just died and that his brother was really sad. And so she said, so I invited them to our table. I'm like, okay. So I, you know, at first I'm not going to say anything, you know, like, how do you start that conversation in a crowded restaurant on a Friday night, you know? But she was screaming in my ear, tell him that I'm here. She said he was drinking too much and he was driving carelessly and it's not his time to go. And she told me that they were soulmates, you know, that they were deeply in love with each other. So I finally told him that she was standing next to me and that she told him that he needs to go get grief counseling. And of course he starts crying and, you know, napkins are, you know, moving in his direction. And he wanted to know why she wasn't talking to him. And I said, well, your energy is low right now. And it's kind of a skill set. I can certainly teach you this, but, he called me on Monday and, told me that he had found a grief therapist and that he was going to start the therapy. So So it does happen. I have a rule that has to be like an arterial bleed, you know, that it has to be really serious for the other side to interrupt my off time.
I love this. It's like your hours that you list, you know, it's like the old school on account, you know, you'd have the door with like, I'm open these hours. You're like, I am not open for business unless it is code red. You're not coming through. It's not happening.
Exactly.
That's amazing. What a great story. Oh my gosh. Wow.
Yeah.
I'm sure you have so many more like that.
So many. So yeah.
It's a reminder. We're so loved. We're not far apart. They're here. It's so soothing, you know, it's so reassuring. Thank you for sharing that. It's beautiful.
Sure.
I want to ask about before, I mean, this, I'm already seeing, I'm like, we might have to have you come back because I already have so many other questions. I'm like, oh my gosh, Marie, there's just so much that we're talking about here. That's really, there's a lot of depth to it. But what I do want to make sure we get to is you had mentioned earlier about, you know, our ability to heal ourselves and the importance of understanding healing from that shifted perspective. And I feel like there's a lot of, juice to squeeze in this topic. So I'll let you pull it wherever you want, whatever thread. Yeah.
There is a lot of juice to squeeze on this topic. Not only does the healer, whoever that is, if you're healing yourself or whatnot, need to change his or her perception all the time and not look at things from a logical perspective, but we're also helping our clients or people that we're working with to have a completely different perception about their healing, because modern medicine says, this is what it is. This is what you have to do to heal it. And I'm not against how people heal. I personally don't care, you know, and I'm always surprised when I do, because I see a lot of very ill people because of my background, although I'm not a practicing nurse and I left the hospital in 2000 and had a full practice ever since. And then just moved into writing and teaching and podcasting and all of those fun things too. Here's an interesting example. I was on somebody else's platform and I was doing readings for their audience, and I couldn't see anyone. So everybody was like, I didn't see their pictures. There wasn't a gallery. So I could hear this man talking and he told me he had a growth in his hand. And so even when people are telling me what's going on with them, which in my practice, we don't take an intake form. I don't want to know what's wrong with someone because I want my intuition to guide me. Most of the time, by the time someone seeks someone like me, even if they're not very ill, in my opinion anyway, they've already seen people. They've had checkups, they've seen therapists, whatever, you know. So I don't know what's going on with people and I like going in cold because then I have a totally different perception than what they've received from modern medicine or from therapists or whatnot. So he told me he had a growth in his hand and I immediately in my brain had a vision of a wart with these little tentacles moving out. He'd already had two surgeries on the hand and the growth kept coming back. He then told me it was cancer, but I didn't ignore what I saw intuitively. I stayed with my intuitive perception, even though my mind probably wanted to go, it's cancer, what are you doing? But I've been doing this for so long, you know, I don't allow my mind to go there the majority of the time. And he was about to have his third surgery. And this time he was going to be very disfigured and not be able to use his hand well because it had kept spreading. So I told him what I was seeing. I go, well, I believe you that it's cancerous, but I'm seeing a wart and I know exactly what you need to do. Because I could also see what he needed. I said, you need near infrared and red light therapy. I told him about the panels that I recommend that are FDA approved. And so he went ahead. So he was ready. He was also part of a community that was open to alternative ways to do things. So he used the therapy. He did not need the surgery. His doctors asked him, what are you doing? And they told him, and luckily they didn't, they go, just keep doing what you're doing. You know, and then he said to me, he goes, I changed my thyroid medication. Do you think that was it? I go, I don't think it was, but I said, I don't care what it is. I'm so happy that that growth is no longer in your hand. I also explained to him energetically how the hand connects to our energy system. And each one of the chakras has an emotional component. And most people are not aligned to the authentic emotion that governs that part of their body. And so if we can get them into alignment about that, you know, then that can actually aid and, you know, move their healing process. So that's one way where the healer, whoever that is for someone, needs to follow their own intuition because it's meaningful, it's necessary. And then there are a lot of clients that I have who are like, they're on the precipice of having a disease process. Like their doctors are like, you know, you have smoldering myelinoma. Like it's not fully myelinoma. No, I can't say that, but it's smoldering. Or, you know, people are worried that things are going to come back, you know, that they've had some serious health issues or even chronic autoimmune system, you know, diseases, which modern medicine does not know how to heal successfully, in my opinion. Although some people do well with reducing their immune system and then they refired it up, but that's a small percentage of people. Most people need to have their immune system rebuilt, you know, through nutrition or supplements, but also their perception. So a lot of the times I'm teaching people, like, even though you have this thing that might turn into something, why can't you celebrate that it hasn't? Why can't you be in a, you know, so I'm constantly working with their brains because our brains are very powerful and people don't manage their mind. They allow it to have this incredible freedom to mostly go into negativity and fear and anxiety, again, activating their adrenal glands, elevating their cortisol levels. And that's not actually helping them to heal. That's part of my work is even changing stories. I had a client who had pancreatic cancer. As far as I know, she's still on the planet and doing very well, which I'm grateful for. She had a very successful surgery and treatments, but she had to change her mind about something. It's very personal, so I can't share the actual topic, but it was so intense and really scary. And I had to change, it had to do with their family dynamics. I had to help her change her perception about it so that she wouldn't be in this reaction that I think made her ill. So that's one of the things I do all day long.
Yeah, this is, well, and what I love about everything you're saying, Marie, is you obviously are so gifted and skilled. And I mean, that's like a whole other level. And individually, we have this power. I think sometimes we forget our mind, our brain, you know, not the logic side, but the way that we tell stories about ourselves, what you're talking about. We have so much power. That's what I love, is we can do something about that. And that is one of the things I just love about you and your energy and your work. And, you know, it's so empowering. And it puts that power back in the client and the patient's hand, in our hands, which is
absolutely
huge.
I couldn't agree more. You know, that I love modern medicine too. We need it. You know, if I need open heart surgery, I want a skilled cardiologist who's going to dive into my body and successfully do whatever needs to be done. And we have all these other aspects, and that having a different perception and not diving into constant fear and fight or flight, which is a big part of the human experience, can radically affect our life and our well-being.
Yeah, it's beautiful. Before we close, I'm wondering, I usually ask it this way, like if you have a heart, I call them heart flares, where your heart is like, I have something to say. I'm going to ask you and your team of light, your guides, like if there's a message through you that maybe I didn't ask you something, or just a message that is coming through you that you would like to share with our beautiful listeners.
Yeah. As soon as you said, I have not heard these lovely terms that you're using, like heart flare, but as soon as you said the team, I just felt this, you know, and I heard something, and they said, get ready. Your light is turning on. Your own flash of genius is becoming obvious and clear to you. Get ready. And this is for you, of course, but everyone who's listening, get ready, because you're about to dive into your magnificence. And allow it to, you know, surprise you and delight you. and stay in alignment with that beautiful light of your authenticity, because that's who we are. You know, we don't bring all of our soul to earth. We only bring a percentage of it. The rest is left in the heavens. That's what many people refer to as their higher self. And when we raise our vibration, we have instant connection with that knowingness, that greater abundance of consciousness that is a part of us that we will join when our energy leaves earth and goes up to the heavens and reconnects with the whole aspect of ourselves. But we can have every beautiful connection with it while we're living here on earth and allow life to be heaven here for each of us.
Oh, that is so stunning, so beautiful. And it's occurring to me that's another way to look at the whole idea of your you is to you, is that connection that, like, I saw a snap. It snaps in to your, thank you for sharing that. I love that. Get ready. That's for all of us. Get ready. Your light. Gosh, Marie, thank you. I love your energy. I love your wisdom. Your, you feel like a 5,000-year-old soul in like a young body.
I take it as a great compliment. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. And I love your energy. Love it. Love it. Love it. You know, thank you so much for inviting me to spend time with you today and your audience. And thank you so much for being in that beautiful spark of insight so we can have these beautiful conversations that have depth and quality to them. Even if people don't fully understand, it can, which I'm sure your audience does, but it can spark all kinds of uniqueness within them that allows them to expand into this greater good that is normal for all of us.
Absolutely. Amen. And so it is. Yeah.
So it is. Thank you.
My friend, I'm so grateful and honored to be here with you on your journey and being your USU. Thank you for watching this episode, for being part of this incredible community and this mission to really step into your light, to your highest purpose. I believe that as we all do that, we all can really be our best selves and uplift consciousness and in humanity. So thank you. I also wanted to say that if you are looking for greater support right now, maybe you're having a health concern or you're looking to really step into that next version, best version of yourself, please come connect with me, whether it's for more resources or coaching or guidance. I would love to support you in any way that I can. Just go to juliereisler.com. You can book a powerful one-on-one breakthrough session there. You can connect with me. I would love to meet you. I'd love to hear how I can be on this journey with you. And before I forget, if you'd like a little more of this good vibe tribe and would like to digest these episodes with a high vibe community, just go to Facebook and look up the Youest You podcast community. You'll find us there. Love always. And thank you so much for taking the time and energy to truly stepping into your authenticity and being your USU.